Hebrews chapter 11. We're continuing our series, The Way Forward, and we introduced this section last week, the first seven verses of Hebrews 11. We'll be covering verses 8 to 22 today and then finishing up chapter 11 next week. But this is the way forward by faith, the way forward by faith. As chapter 11 opened up, actually as chapter 10 closed down, we do not belong to those who shrink back and are destroyed, but to those who have faith and are saved. The author of Hebrews is speaking of this confidence that he has in these believers, that they won't shrink back, that they will heed the warning and see Jesus for who he is and continue to persevere after Jesus Christ. Their faith will prove itself genuine. And then he goes into then, what is faith? Faith is, verse 1 of chapter 11, confidence, assurance in what we hope for, and a conviction about what we do not see. The author describes what faith is here, the assurance that we are placing our hope, and that what we are placing our hope in will occur, and the conviction, that inner resolve that the unseen things that God is promising us are real. This week we're going to move into then the living out of this faith within the family of Abraham. You know, faith that is real, faith that is genuine, an assurance, a conviction of things that we're hoping for that we do not yet see, that they are genuine. Think about what was asked of some of these men. Think about Abraham. We're going to look at his story in a moment here. But I was trying to think of how to modern day illustrate this. This would be like somebody like, I'm not saying Jeff Bezos is God, although Amazon seems to be trying to function that way in our world today. But imagine Jeff Bezos coming to you, the founder and owner of Amazon, and asking you to enter into this new venture that he has. You're going to have to leave everything here and move to this deserted region of, let's just say, Mexico. And you'll never be able to return from there. You will move there permanently, and you will live there, and you will have no more contact ever again with any of what you are leaving behind. But the promise is that he has this new venture, this company that he is starting down there, that it will take all of your time, resources, energy to commit yourself to. But on the other end of this, you will become great. You will be remembered throughout history. And everything down there will be provided for. And you move down there and you think, this is great. I'll do it. I don't care. I'm going to forsake it all. I'm going to try this. And then decades go by, and you move to this region, and it's still this barren area, and it's not this huge mansion that you were anticipating, but it's kind of just this RV that's down there that you're going to live on, and you're going to roam around the central parts of Mexico in. And while he sets you up in this business, the business never really materializes, and it's there, but you're not seeing it, and there's just no way that you can possibly foresee how this is going to turn into some great thing that I'm going to be remembered for all time. How long do you stay committed to the vision of Jeff Bezos? Would you stick it out all the way to the end? Now, I know God is much bigger than Jeff Bezos. But what was being asked of Abraham was something like that. I mean, we would have confidence that Jeff Bezos could do this because he is the richest man on earth. We know he's got the resources to make this happen. But would we commit our entire life? Would we have that much confidence and assurance and faith to give ourselves completely to that? What was asked of Abraham was essentially this. We see Abraham's faith in action throughout his family. We learn a number of lessons here. Let's start in verse 8. It says this about Abraham. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would, my goodness, I can't even read that, he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. The first aspect of faith that we see out of Abraham's family is this: faith follows God even when we don't know where he is leading. You know, there are times we'll get into a car and drive not knowing where we are going. And I've mentioned this before. We've done this with dinner sometimes. You know, you get in the car and you have no idea where we're going for dinner. But my girls sometimes do this with Tia. They don't do this with me too often, but sometimes they just want to talk. That mother-daughter talk. And so they'll just get in the car and drive. And probably because I'm in the house at the time, and they're like, we got to get away from Dad, right? And so they'll drive sometimes for hours and just talk. Is there any direction to where they're going? No, it doesn't matter. That's not what it's about. Sometimes we will do that. But very few of us would ever pack up all of our possessions, rent a moving truck, load that truck, and start out traveling with no idea as to where we are going. That's what the passage says of Abraham here. He obeyed, having no idea where this was going to end. God called Abraham, and he promised Abraham that he would make him into a great nation, Genesis 12. He told him that he would bless him and make his name great, and through him all the nations on the earth would be blessed. And while we tend to think that Abraham's faith started in Genesis 15, verse 6, where it says Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness, and Paul makes such a big deal about that in a passage like Romans chapter 4, I would suggest Abraham's faith started earlier than that. In order to do what Abraham did in giving up all of it and basically blindly following God to wherever God told him to stop, that took an incredible amount of faith on Abraham's part. That choice to follow God at this directive was the beginning of Abraham's faith. And we see here a truth about faith, that faith stems from an encounter with God. God comes to Abraham. He confronts Abraham. And Abraham then believes. Our faith starts when God encounters us. We don't generate faith. Faith is our assurance. It's our conviction in what God is saying to us. And so that encounter with the gospel, that work of the Holy Spirit, confronts us with the reality of God. And that starts, the Bible talks about this in different ways, but it starts generating in us, I don't know, a hope or whatever that we start then placing our trust in, our faith in, our life in. This work of God, of him confronting us. And the question remains, just as it did for Abraham, will we exercise our faith? Will we follow God? Are you and I willing to follow wherever God leads? You see, faith, and this is what we're talking about here, faith is faith in action. Faith isn't just knowing and understanding a series of propositional statements about God and our having that knowledge of that. Faith is taking what we know about God and putting it into action. That's where faith really is seen. Are we willing to follow wherever God leads? Some of you might ask, well, how do I know that God is leading me? Is God leading me? And how do I understand where he is leading me and where am I supposed to go? That is a great question, because people sometimes come up to us and say, well, God is telling me to do this. Well, how do you know God is telling you to do this? Well, I got this burden that I need to do this. Oh, I mean, that can be a part of it. But not all of the burdens that we come up with or the thoughts that we have are guaranteed for us to be from God. We follow God day by day. We enter into his word. We submit ourselves to his direction from his word, the clear commands of his word. We pray with him. We connect to his body, the church. We serve within the body. And I would suggest to you, as we follow God day by day, as we submit to the commands in His Word, as we connect into and serve within the body, that's when we start sensing God's call upon our lives. This is the example of Paul in Acts 13, isn't it 13, I think, is where he's called on that first missionary journey. He and Barnabas are involved in that church at Antioch, and God says, call out, set apart for me, Paul, separate out Paul and Barnabas for the mission that I have. Look for the opportunities to sacrificially give, serve here, now, and God calls. I'm going to put the Heinrichs on display. I'm sorry, Kurt and Amy, but you're probably leaving here in the next week or two, right? So you won't have to live with the aftermath. It's good. They gave their testimony a few weeks ago, but the Heinrichs were a part of Clearwater Community Church for a number of years. And Kurt was moving toward retiring from the Coast Guard, and they connected into this body. They were a part of the global outreach team and all of those sorts of things. They had missions on their mind. They were praying about that. And then they started sensing God's call upon their life to the particular field that God laid out for them. And I would suggest they find themselves now right smack dab in the middle of God's will for their life. That's how God leads today. Faith follows God even when we don't know now where He might be leading. He will direct. Step out in faith. Secondly, faith resides in a world that is not our home. Verse 9, by faith, Abraham made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city with foundations whose architect and builder is God. Faith resides in a world that is not our home. When Abraham and his family arrived in the land that God had promised, they didn't settle into the land and build homes. That's not what happened. They were a nomadic people. They lived in tents, and they continuously moved and were moving around based on where land was available for their flocks and cattle to graze. We see throughout the Genesis account again and again this family bumping into different people groups, sometimes leading to very difficult circumstances. It was as if they were a people without a country, without a homeland. And in fact, they would be for the next hundreds of years through the lives of Abraham, through the lives of Isaac, through the lives of Jacob, even through their time in Egypt. From this, the author of Hebrews draws the larger theological point that in this physical world, God's people are not residents. We are aliens. And when we hear that term today, that definitely rings true, because in our societal bigger picture of things, the idea of a legal versus an illegal alien, we understand that concept. But here's what we need to grasp as Christians. In a sense, we are illegal aliens in this world. We're the exiles. We're the migrants. We're those. This is not our home. Do we see ourselves as aliens in this country, America? Because what the Bible would suggest is that's who we are as Christians. I know we were born here. I know this is our homeland. We root for the Americans mostly when we're watching the Olympics. I get that. But this is not our home. It doesn't mean that we don't say it. We say absolutely nothing when we see culture seemingly going to hell. We do stand up for our rights at times, but we don't place our hope here. We don't place our hope in the individuals of this country. We don't place our hope in the systems of this country. We don't place our hope in the political parties of this country, because all of that will eventually let us down, because none of that is God. And we don't follow the stuff of this country or the stuff of the world. We follow God. We should be able to view ourselves as aliens in this world because it's not our home. God is the architect and builder of a city that still awaits us in the future. And as his people, that city that God is preparing for us, that's our dwelling place. We live in community right now with one another to hold out the hope for this world that this isn't our home, but these people make up what will be our dwelling place with God someday. So in a sense, we are countercultural as exiles communing together within this world that is not our home. And so I ask us again, Christian, do we see this world? Do we see America as our home, or do we see the city that God is creating as our home? We don't serve President so-and-so, whoever that might be. And perhaps sometimes you're going to like that, and then sometimes you might think that you do need to serve him or his agenda or whatever. We serve whom? King Jesus. And he's not incarnated in an American president. That's just not going to be how it goes. We're exiles here. Faith resides in a world that is not its home. Thirdly, faith receives the impossible because we focus on the faithful promise. Verse 11, and by faith, even Sarah, who was past childbearing age, was enabled to bear children because she considered him faithful who had made the promise. And so from this one man, and he as good as dead, what a descriptor of Abraham there, right? Came descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as countless as the sand on the seashore. Faith receives the impossible, the improbable, because we focus on the faithful promise. You know, amid all the exploits of Abraham in Genesis, a dark cloud loomed constantly overhead. Like Abraham, we are always aware throughout this story of the harsh reality of what? Even though God had promised Abraham all of these things, they were not able, he and Sarah, to what? Bear a child. There's always that in the background of this story. Because of that reality, frustration set in. Abraham and Sarah made some very unwise decisions. Ultimately, fracture happened within the family of Abraham. Abuse, physical abuse, happened within the household of Abraham. Yet finally, after decades of frustration and probably having reached a time when they simply didn't think it was physically possible that this child would happen through Abraham and Sarah, God showed up and promised a child within a year. And Abraham and Sarah believed God, right? They would receive the child. That's what Hebrews says of all of this. But is something doesn't ring true with us, right? Because we know the Genesis account. It doesn't look that simple in the Genesis account. It doesn't look that optimistic. When God even comes then and says it, what happens? What's the reaction? There's laughing, almost like a mocking laughter at God. There's no way this is possible. I mean, this would be people, I know they're 190 when this happens, but they lived longer too. So it would probably be people in their mid-60s who for 40 years of trying have had no success at bearing a child, now conceiving. That's virtually impossible. And yet that's what happened with Abraham and Sarah. And yet when that message comes, their faith, although Hebrews talks about it as faith, still had doubts, still laughed at God. And I think we learn a real key aspect of faith here. A life of faith will still have doubts at times. Faith doesn't mean that we are completely so certain that we never doubt or ever have doubts run through our minds. I don't think the Bible promises us that. All you have to do is read the Psalms. There's lots of questioning of God in the Psalms. A lot of God, what is going on here? A lot of God, act, I need you to act now. I think a life of faith still has doubt. But during doubt, how does one respond? What does one do? Here's faith in action again. Faith in the midst of doubts does what? It continues to trust and obey God. It might question God, but it continues to trust Him. It continues to persevere toward Him. It continues to obey what His Word says. That's faith. You know, sometimes we think, well, I can't ever question God. Trust me, God wants you to come. Why go elsewhere with that? Lay the burden on Him. He cares for you. His shoulders are big enough to hold our questions, our concerns. But that demonstrates faith, that we continue to go to Him with that. You see, no faith would give up and walk away. But faith continues to trust and obey. Doubts and questions should drive us towards God. They should cause us to ask and consider. They should not drive us away from Him. Despite the impossible circumstances, faith trusts God and follows Him. And at times, we will doubt. And I love that verse in 2 Timothy 2 that says, sometimes even we will what? We are faithless. But He will still be faithful. Our faith will shake and waver at times. It will doubt at times. But true faith sticks it out. It looks to God. It trusts God. It obeys God. And I do want to give one caveat here about faith receiving the impossible because we focus on the faithful promiser. This applies to what God has said and promised, not to our notions of what we think God should do. Sometimes we have this preconceived idea that God should act this way toward me, and we'll put all kinds of faith in that, and we will pray in that direction. I'm not saying that God's going to give you every single thing you think you should get. And just because you have enough faith in it, God will answer it. There's no guarantee of that in Scripture. Because sometimes what we think from our finite and still marred by sin perspective might not be God's will. But faith receives what God promises us, what God says in His Word to us. So by faith, we trust that God can do the impossible, and we pray to that end, and we trust whatever direction He gives towards us. You know, we still pray for the impossible and the miraculous in the lives of others when they're going through sickness or disease or cancer. Does that mean God's always going to answer those exactly how we want? No. Can God still do the healing? Yes, because He's the miracle worker, and so we place our faith and trust in Him in that. But we also continue to trust even when our way isn't what's best in His way. That's faith. Fourthly, we see from the family of Abraham and the testimony here that faith continues all the way to death, even if God's promises aren't fully realized in our lifetime. Notice verse 16. All these people in Abraham's family here were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance, admitting that they were foreigners and strangers on earth. People who say such things show that they are looking for a country of their own. If they had been thinking of the country they had left, they would have opportunity to return. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. The entire family of Abraham serves as an example that true faith in God perseveres despite the fact that one isn't receiving the promises of God. Physically, maybe not even at all within this lifetime. We saw a few weeks ago the statement that, I think it was even last week, that God rewards or is a rewarder of those who seek him. And this begs the question then for us, are we in this simply for the reward of what we think we will get out of our relationship with God? Are we in a relationship with God simply for what we will get out of it? The reward. You know, some follow God for fame. They look to God to make them known. They pursue God or the things of God because it will make them famous. Some follow God for riches, that they can enrich themselves off of this following of God. Some follow God for relationships with others. They feel that need to be accepted, and so they follow God so that they have relationship with others. All of these things might be a byproduct of a relationship with God. And we may choose to follow God because we fear what awaits us on the other side of this life. Yet I still wonder when we follow God, would we follow God if it is only about a relationship with him and nothing else? Would you and I follow God if we would not see any of the fulfillment of any of these things, of any of these expectations in this life? Can we truly look past our own physical circumstances, regardless of what happens to us in this world, and still follow God simply because of what remains ahead of us, a relationship with him in glory? Because that might be what's asked of us. That we won't see in this life physical blessing. We won't see fame. We won't see acceptance by others. But we are promised a relationship with God in the future if we continue to trust and place our faith in this God, in his sacrifice for us in Jesus Christ. Do we see what lies ahead of us in this relationship with him in glory and welcome that with the result that we are strangers and aliens in the physical here and now? That's what the family of Abraham did. The people that please God are those walking by faith in this world, not embracing the things of this world, but looking forward to that future with God. And Hebrews says here that God is proud to call those his children. Those are his. Faith perseveres all the way to death, even if we don't see the promises realized. But the counter to that is the fifth point here that we see from the family of Abraham in verses 17 to 19. Faith gives what God requests, even that when this would seem to jeopardize our understanding of God's promises. Notice 17, by faith Abraham, when God tested him, offered Isaac as a sacrifice. He who had embraced the promises was about to sacrifice his one and only son. You know, just in verse 13, it talked about the fact that they did not receive the promises. Here, Abraham had received the promises. He saw Isaac born. And yet he was willing to sacrifice his one and only son, even though God had said to him, "It is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned." Abraham reasoned that God could even raise the dead, and so in a manner of speaking, he did receive Isaac back from the dead. You know, while many of us will be called to live by faith, and we must await the promise of that future time with him, we do, and many of us do, see blessings out of that relationship with God right now. We see promises of God fulfilled in our lifetime. We see some of those things. God taking care of us, providing for us, bringing us into relationship with others, putting His blessing upon our lives. Abraham finally saw God's promises fulfilled in his son Isaac. He saw all that God had promised in that child. But the ultimate test of Abraham's faith occurred when God came and asked Abraham to offer up Isaac, to give him up, to hand him back over to God, the promised son. And Abraham's faith proved genuine by his willingness to offer up what God had promised. The blessings of God were there, and yet Abraham was willing to say, I will give these blessings back to you, God. His faith enabled him to believe that Isaac remained God's promised child, so he could believe that God would even do the impossible again and raise Isaac from the dead if he offered him. When God stayed Abraham's hand from killing his son, in essence, he was receiving Isaac back from the dead. When we hear this and we see words like one and only son, what comes to mind? Jesus. Because what Abraham was asked by God to do, and God took him all the way up to the place where he basically has the knife raised to offer up his son, God stopped Abraham. He knew Abraham's faith after the testing was genuine. And yet God did not stop there with Jesus Christ. Rather, he offered Jesus Christ as the sacrifice for our sin. Isaac and Abraham serve as a type of something that God would ultimately do so that we could come into relationship. I ask us today, are we able to hand over to God those blessings He has promised to us? Are we willing to lay down, not in some physical act, but to allow God to use our children, our grandchildren, in any way He deems best? Are we willing to let go of that and let God use them? Are we willing to give up our comfortable life in the here and now in the United States? Are we willing to set that aside to follow where God leads and directs? Are we willing to set aside a job? Are we willing to even set aside some ministry that we are involved in right now because God is asking us to step out in faith into something real? From our perspective, we don't know if greater, but it's where God is telling us to go. Are we willing to? Faith gives what God requests, even when it seems like we're giving up what He's promised to us. And lastly, faith looks to the future to see the realization of God's promises. In verses 20 to 22, we see the offspring of Abraham here. By faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau in regard to their future. By faith, Jacob, when he was dying, blessed each of Joseph's sons and worshipped as he leaned on top of his staff. And by faith, Joseph, when his end was near, spoke about the exodus of the Israelites from Egypt and gave instructions concerning the burial of his bones. These key descendants of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph, each get a verse describing faith, their faith. And they all share a commonality here. Once again, these men did not see the promise made to their family fulfilled within their lifetime. Isaac didn't see it. Jacob didn't see it. Even Joseph did not see that land that God had promised, that homeland with the people settled in it. Yet they were able to see into the future of what God had in store for this family. And they acted, or maybe even better, they spoke accordingly. Both Isaac and Jacob pass on blessing to that next generation. Joseph speaks about the Exodus and gives instruction for what should be done with his bones after his death. They all are anticipating a time where God will fulfill this for their family, and they speak and testify about that reality to their family. They pass it on to the next generation. Their faith remained throughout their life, all the way up to their passing from this life, even as they did not receive what God had promised them. And again, we are reminded that our faith might not be sight this side of glory. Yet we believe, and our faith testifies, that our hope is still true. We can still garner assurance. We have a conviction that these unseen things are real, even if it awaits us after we pass from this life into the next. Faith perseveres all the way to the end. And let me suggest to you, that's the greatest legacy that you can leave in this world, is a testimony of faith in the promises of God. What your children and your grandchildren, your family needs more than anything else is for you to leave them that legacy, that testimony of a faith that continues to endure. That in their day-to-day interactions, they see a mom, a dad, a grandparent who is in God's word, that this word is real in their life, that they pray and have an active relationship with the God of this universe. And that as that is modeled to them, that faith can be passed on to them. The call of faith from this passage is this: to trust God no matter how your life is playing out this side. Trust God. Place your faith in Him, in His word, in His promises, believer. Maybe you're here today with us and you've never come to a place where you've placed your faith and trust in God. God offered up His only Son, Jesus Christ, for your sins, so that as we place our faith and trust in Jesus Christ, not in our own actions, not in our own tradition, but as that gospel truth sinks in and we are confronted with what God has done for us in Jesus Christ, all we do is respond by placing our faith and trust in Him, and we can be saved. But as a believer, we must continue to trust God no matter how our life is playing out this side of glory. It will come to fruition one day. You know, we're watching the Olympics these past couple of weeks, and I think they're wrapping up. I think they probably wrapped up in the middle of the night last night. There's closing ceremonies or something left. But one of the stories that stuck out to me in this Olympic time is that they kept putting 2021 or 2020 up there, not 2021, right? It throws you off a year. But this Olympic season was one of the key hallmark games is always the gymnastics. And one of the things that stood out to me was not Simone Biles, although she was part of how all of this unfolded, but was this other lesser known gymnast on the American team named Michaela Skinner, who is 24 years old. She's pretty much at the end of her gymnastics career, and it's about time for her to retire. I know that sounds crazy that you would retire at 24, but as a gymnast, you need to. And she has been a part of U.S. gymnastics for a number of years now, and yet she's never gotten a medal. In the last Olympics, when the team won the gold medal, she was the alternate on that team. She was not one of the five members that got to compete. This was supposed to be kind of her last shot at it. And again, she didn't make the four-member team. She was left off of that four-member team, so she could not get a medal that way. They did invite her to the Olympics as one of the American gymnasts to try to qualify herself in an individual event. And she's really good at a couple of events. One is the vault, the one where they run down the runway and then they jump off the springboard and they flip through the air and land and they get judged on that, right? So she's really good at that. In the prelims, though, she finished fourth place to get to the medal round. And that would usually qualify you, except two Americans qualified ahead of her, and the rules state that only two people from a country can be in one of these events. So even though she finished fourth and had a really good shot at a medal, she was kept out of the finals. It looked like her career was over. Decade maybe 2 decades of all of this training to never see it fulfilled. And yet when Simone Biles stepped out of it because of all of the craziness that was happening in her mind and everything else over the past few weeks, and she finally did get a medal at the end, which was really great to see, but she stepped out of that particular competition, it opened up a slot for this other girl to have one more chance at a medal, because now only one American was in there and she could come in. She finished second and she got a silver medal, and you could just see on her face this amazing sense of satisfaction that after all of these years, I finally got my shot and saw it fulfilled. I can now go off into retirement at 24, right? Sounds crazy. But it was just reminding me, because when she didn't qualify, the sadness that was there, and you could just see the dejection, and it was over, and she was on a plane ticket basically back to the States, and then to get that news, to have one more chance to see it all fulfilled. We would love for it to all work out in our lifetime. But we're not guaranteed that as followers of Christ. That we will see the fulfillment of all that we anticipate this side of glory. Oh, God will give us glimpses. And God will bring blessing on some of us. But some of us will really be tested throughout this life. For some of you, you seemingly have it all, and life is going great. I think the challenge of this passage of faith is don't get distracted by the things of this world. You're an alien here. This is not your home. But for others, you are going through severe testing. You are not seeing the fulfillment of the promises, and it's so easy to get frustrated and to feel this weight and to think, is this all real? Should I continue this? Remember where your focus is. It's on Jesus Christ and what God has done for you in Jesus Christ. And as you look to that, and as you think on that, and as you ponder that, as we will do in a moment when we take communion here, we are reminded again and again that our future hope isn't here. And God might take a loved one. And God might not heal my own sickness. And God might call me home from to glory earlier than I would anticipate. And God might not give me what I see these Christians over here experiencing. But your hope isn't in the seen things of this world. It's in the unseen. It's in the future. And if we keep our focus on Jesus Christ and continue to trust and obey God by faith and act out of that faith, He will accomplish every single thing He wants through our lives. And there will be no greater commendation, there will be no greater medal that we could ever receive than to stand before His judgment seat one day and hear those words. Continue to live by faith. And it's not an isolated thing. It's something done in community of faith. That's why we have this church. If you're a struggling believer, please seek one of us out. We would love to come alongside you, and as Galatians 6 speaks about, bear that burden alongside you. By faith. Let's close in a word of prayer as we enter into a time of communion. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the truthfulness of it. We thank you for the promises in it. And Lord, help us to realize that like Abraham and like his family, we might not see these promises come to fruition this side of glory. But all of that is probably a testing to see whether our faith is genuine. And Lord, if our faith is genuine because your Holy Spirit has truly birthed us again, as we hear this word, encourage us to continue to believe, to trust, to walk with you. Give us direction as to where you have us going. Help us to make sense, Lord, out of some of these circumstances that we're going through in life right now. bind us together in community with one another. And Lord, I pray for all of the members of Clearwater Community Church that you would help us to endure and persevere by faith to the very end. And Lord, those whose faith is wavering, I pray that you would either bolster it and strengthen it, or show them and bring them to the place where they need to truly trust Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. All of this is possible because you didn't stay your hand, but you allowed your one and only Son to be offered so that we could inherit the promises and the glory that is promised to Jesus Christ. So, Lord, as we move to communion, may we celebrate that now, and may this encourage us to continue to walk by faith. We pray all of this in Jesus' name.